So thanks much for the invitation to participate in this meeting and represent the Insight mission. So it's a big week for Insight because it's going through its preliminary design review this week. So it's the reason why Bruce Banner, the PI, asked me to represent the mission. So Insight is a discovery mission that was recently selected, and it's scheduled to launch in March 2016 and get to Mars in September 2016. Sorry. And the basic science goal for Insight is to understand the formation and evolution of terrestrial planets through a very elaborate geophysical observation plan. And this will lead to better understanding the interior structure and processes of Mars that applies to other telluric bodies. This is directly aligned with the science interest of various plants in the US with the Decadal Survey, but also, you know, internationally. It's an international mission that involves partners for instruments in Europe. So that's the busiest slide I have. The others are, you know, with movies and so on. But just to give you an idea of the motivation for that type of mission and why it's so important, it's the first mission of its kind. The interior of a planet, it retains the signature of its origin, with, you know, some effect of geophysical. I'm sorry. Yeah, it doesn't work. Sorry about that. So it's so a planet form, and you know it has some evolution, and it's like a mystery. You are looking for clues that will tell you information about the origin of the body. The origin of the body traces directly back to the origin of the solar system. If we can understand better the origin of the solar system, we understand the origin of Earth, and this leads to understanding the origin of life in the inner solar system. So the interior is key to many things, and especially to driving endogenic activity, geological activity, providing it's a heat source for geological activity, and it participates in all dynamic systems of the planet. It's the source of the atmosphere, as we understand it, for the telluric bodies, for Earth and for Mars and Venus. It's a source and sink for energy, rock, for water, and so on. So it's very important, it's a key in understanding the foundation for a planet to become and remain habitable. We have information on the interiors of only two terrestrial bodies so far. Earth, of course, but the problem with Earth, with tracing back to the origin, is that the surface of Earth has been erased by extensive geological activity through plate tectonics, convection and plate tectonics. And the moon, it's been, you know, the object of a lot of observations, so geophysical, like the Grail mission, seismic measurements during the Apollo era. But the problem is that it was formed under very unique circumstances. The current state of understanding for the origin of the moon is that it formed as a consequence of a big impact with Earth. And as such, the moon may have preserved the chemistry only of the outer, you know, 200 kilometers of the early Earth. So it's certainly very interesting to explore the moon in order to better understand Earth. But observing Mars would be, breakthrough new observations in this search for understanding our origin, because it's closer to Earth in many regards, in size and so on. And also, it's not evolved as much as Earth. So it has preserved more information about the origins. So how does the terrestrial planet form? Well, it forms from the accretion of meteoritic materials. It's something that is very well understood. There is a main belt of asteroids that contain remnants of the building blocks of the telluric bodies. And there is the Dawn mission, which is currently on its way to Ceres after observing Vesta for a while. So through Dawn, we have some clues about these early stages of planetary developments and protoplanet formation. So that's the first step. And as it grows above a certain size, body is going to start melting. The interior is going to start melting as a consequence of an internal heat source, which is the disintegration of radioactive isotopes. And then something happens. And that something is going to depend on many parameters, especially about the size of the body and its capacity at retaining heat. And this is where InSight can help us understand what that stuff is. And that could be, you know, convection, that could be core overturn, but we need to increase our number of sampling points across the solar system in order to understand what that stuff is. In the end, so what we observe today is a body which, in the case of Earth, Venus, and Mars, and Mercury, is differentiated into a crust, mantle, and core. So that's what we are left to deal with. So Mars is key to understanding the early formation of terrestrial planets, and especially rocky exoplanets. They all share this structural framework of having a crust, a mantle, and a core. And it's believed that this differentiation, this chemical differentiation of the interior occurs very rapidly after formation. So the question is how much evolution happens after that very early stage of differentiation. So this charts show, you know, that we expect to have the same type of evolution for Mercury, Venus, Earth, Moon, and Mars. But these are based on models. They are based on geophysical models, taking as a key input the amount of heat available from radiogenic isotopes, as well as some ideas of what the composition, the original composition of these objects was. Mars is uniquely well-suited to study the common processes that shape all planetary bodies, rocky planets, sorry, and that are going to determine their basic habitability potential. There is a strong evidence that there is going to be, there is a strong evidence for Mars that it's not evolved a lot after formation, that it's preserved its very basic structure following differentiation. So that's very important. And its surface is much more accessible, of course, than Mercury and Venus. But we are very lucky to have the Messenger mission right now observing Mercury. So that's another sampling point that will be very, very helpful for comparative planetology with the future InSight observations. So how does the internal structure provide a window into planetary space? You know, what is the scientific fundamentals of the InSight mission? So first, the crust, its thickness and its structure, the density profile and, you know, chemical profile, reflect the depth and crystallization processes of the magma ocean, the early magma ocean following accretion. And it's very important because it's the upper boundary condition of the internal evolution systems. Surface temperature, migration of certain, differentiation of certain minerals toward the surface are going to play a big role into the long-term evolution of the interior, and it's going to determine the possibility for internal convection. So the mantle, as possible, there have been possible pathways for the evolution of the mantle. There could have been convection, there could have been partial melting. It's believed that, like on Earth, below the crust, you know, a few tens of kilometers deep, you have a zone of low velocity, low seismic velocity, that could point to some partial melt, and that could have been a source of past volcanic activity. But this needs to be observed. This is just what I'm telling you, it's just based on models. And the core, its size and composition, its density, they reflect the conditions of accretion. It's going to reflect how much heat was available early on for differentiating the object, and this drives whether you had a big core and whether or not this core can remain liquid until present, partially liquid until present. Oula, this was unexpected. This table, I mean, there is a lot of information on this table, but I'm just asking you to focus on the last column, which basically shows how much improvement we expect to get on our understanding, our knowledge of a number of parameters relevant to Mars. You've noted I'm early career at JPL, and I'm very interested in developing missions. The InSight proposal, I mean, it's beautiful. The team has done a very nice work demonstrating what they can expect to get with the InSight payload. So it's very, very nice proposal. And so what they expect to get in terms of improvement is a factor 7 on the crustal thickness. And this is going to be very important, because this is our upper boundary conditions that drives the amount of activity in the mantle. It's going to give us information about the structure of the crust, you know, how much differentiated it is itself, you know, how much chemical complexity there is in the crust. It's going to improve by almost a factor 8 information about the seismic velocity in the mantle. Right now, we only have some forward modeling of the behavior of seismic waves, in Mars mantle. So this will be a new result. We will have definitive conclusion about the nature of the core, whether it's liquid or solid. We will have an improvement by a factor 4 on the core radius, factor 3 on the density, factor 8 on the heat flow, very important to understand how much heat is still available to Mars. And more generally, we'll have an idea of whether or not there is seismic activity on Mars, and that's very important because this can tell us how much tectonic activity there is, especially. And then we'll have information about the meteoritic impact rate, which is of interest to a human exploration of Mars. So for this, the InSight is going to bring a payload that is very elaborate, the first of its kind. First, there's going to be a seismometer to Mars. It's very exciting to have this very elaborate seismometer that covers a very, very wide range of frequencies. It's a combination of very broad band seismology and a short period sensor. And this seismometer needs to be protected from the effect from noise coming from the atmosphere atmospheric activity, wind, thanks to a shield. I'm going to detail this in the next slides. I'm just presenting the instruments. The other very key instrument is the HP3. The heat flow and physical properties probe, which is an instrument that was developed maybe 20 years ago by the German Space Agency and has been proposed during multiple opportunities, for example, for Beagle 2. And the particularity of this instrument that makes it really cool is that it has a mole that allows it to dig 5 meters into Mars. And it's related to the electronic box by a tether. And on this tether, there are thermal sensors. So this will give direct information about the heat flow of Mars. First of its kind, and this type of instrument, it's relatively simple once, you know, we understand how it works, and it could be applied to a variety of future missions. There is a dynamic celestial mechanic experiment, if you want, using the spacecraft telecom in order to have a very fine measurement of Mars rotational properties, which bear implications about the interior structure. I'm going to present this in more details. There is a payload sensor suite that includes a magnetometer, a pressure sensor, and temperature and wind sensors. And there is the instrument deployment system, which is very cool. It's going to play a key role in the deployment of the payload, of course, because all these instruments need to be in contact with the ground. And that's another key aspect of the InSight mission, is that it's, I think it's the first mission that is going to rely very much on articulated arm to deploy the instruments. So there are multiple signal sources on Mars. So there is a great chance that we are going to observe seismic activity. One is faulting. It's not clear how much faulting activity there is on Mars right now, so we'll find out during the length of the mission. And there could be one earthquake every 10,000 years, maybe, and we may be lucky, or there may be more activity than we think. There is also the effect of phobostites. These are very small, but they have some effects that are believed to be we have demonstrated that they can be detected with the seismometer on InSight. More frequently, we expect to get meteorite impacts recorded by the seismometer on InSight. This the number of impacts that have been detected by a combination of Mars Global Surveyor tests and Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter observations. And on this picture on the right, we have a comparison of images obtained with MRO that shows the consequences of an impact on the surface. And these dots, all these points are located, these impact sites are located next to the landing area planned for InSight. So there is a great chance that we will record seismic activity associated with impacting. And then there is atmospheric activity, so the effect of atmospheric loading, and we have the same thing on Earth. So that's also going to create an exciting source, if you want, for the interior, that's going to result in pulsing of the interior, what we call normal modes and spheroidal modes. And that type of exciting source tells us about the deep interior of the planet. Sorry, I'm stuck. Sorry, I can't move anymore. Can someone help? Yeah, I'm sorry. I can't escape, so it's probably crashed.
Just
talking, okay. It's less fun when you don't see the instrument. I had very cool movies about how the mall is going to work and so on, but it's okay. Most of my talk was about movies and showing you the deployment and so on. So I'm not sure what to show you now. Can't we do anything about this? Let me see. Sorry. So InSight is going to be launched in a time window in March 4 to 24. And it's expected to arrive in March 4 to 24, 2016, and it's expected to arrive in September 28. 2016. And the first stages of the missions are going to be about deploying the instruments. So the deployment is in several steps. You have three basic major steps. One is about deploying the seismometer with the arm. The arm is inherited from Mars 01 mission. And on this arm, there are two cameras. And the idea is to have check and control between the ground and Mars, and very slowly, but you know, very safely, look at the deployment as it occurs. Because even if there is a lot of preparation going on right now about the deployment, and there are going to be a lot of rehearsal with the JPL testbed, we don't really know what we are dealing with once on Mars. I mean, there is going to be the effect of wind. There is going to be the fact that at the landing site there may be rocks in the way. And there is a lot of work going on right now about looking for landing sites that are devoid with rocks as much as possible, using the MRO images as a reference. There is a lot of activity with MRO right now about getting high resolution images that give you an information about the amount of rocks at potential landing sites on InSight. And I think that activity is coming to a close. I think there are very good sites that have been identified at this time. So the deployment for the seismometers will be in two main steps. One will be about putting the seismometer. Second step will be about putting the shield. So you can imagine that it's a very delicate type of operations. And so these deployment activities will take several weeks. And then there will be the deployment. The deployment, of the HP3 instruments. And so we will record, I hope we get the movie of the mole going through the surface, because it's really cool. So once there is a deployment, then the science activity will start. So. So without my movies, that's about the end of my talk. But it will be posted, and hopefully it will work on the website. I guess it's a movie that messed up things. I mean, I can, thank you. I can just go to the cool stuff. Since I guess I'm running out of time. So this is the mole that's going to dig into the crust, and there is a taper at the end, at the upper end, that is associated with the electronic box, and it was working. Oh yes, great. So there is a hammering mechanism that is going to drive the motion of the mole forward. And this has been tested in multiple environments at JPL and the German Space Agency. And we know that we are confident that it will go about 5 meters below the surface. And so it's simple, but at the same time, very elegant system where you have a combination of springs that will attenuate the effect. Sorry, how deep is it expected to go? Yeah, about 5 meters. could be, I think in principle it could go more, but the scientific requirement dwarf that 5 meters. The landing site that has been identified for, I mean the general area, sorry, that has been identified for InSight, based on the idea that safety is the number one driver for defining the landing site. And so it won't be very far from Gale Crater and Curiosity. We have good images from that area. And so this presentation, it's a few months old, and the chart on the right shows the many landing ellipses that have been considered for future landing sites, and these are being analyzed by Matt Golombek, especially. He's sharing the landing site and the geology working group, and looking very carefully at the content of these observations by MRO in order to identify places where the rock abundance is minimum. So the surface deployment is really key to the InSight measurements. I mean, there was a seismometer on Viking 1, but it was not deployed. So having seismometers that is not on the ground is not very useful. It's the reason why a lot of the activities in preparation for InSight are about making sure the deployment is going to be successful. So we will take advantage of the payload mass capability of the Phoenix lander. And this deployment activity, I mean, it's unprecedented, and if it works, you know, it's going to pave the way forward for future activities of the same type. And it froze again. So that's InSight after deployment, where you see the seismometer under the shield and the HP3 instrument, and I will and the presentation with a movie that shows you how this thing is going to work. So you see the arm, first pick up the seismometer. You have peaks of what happened in the test bed at JPL. It's going to deploy, so the arm deploys the seismometer on the ground. And you see the tether related to the main craft for passing the data through. And the next step is for the arm to pick up the windshield. So it's a very, very slow process because it's a very detailed type of deployment. And this activity of deployment is going to develop over several weeks. And yeah, so I had more slides about the instruments, but I'm running out of time, so this will be posted on the website. And if you have questions, you can just send me an email. Thanks. So I don't think once the mole is within the ground and it encounters an obstacle, InSight doesn't have the capability to retract the mole and move it to a different place. But the mole has been tested or is being tested on very complex test beds where rocks are involved. And Matt Golombek, who is this long-time geological specialist, has provided input about the type of rocks we should expect in the early surface of Mars. So the mole has the capability to go around the rocks or to directly break the rocks. So we are confident that it's not going to be a major issue. Yeah.
What's the expected duration of the mission? Are you dependent only on solar power?
So we are dependent on solar power, and when the winter season comes, the activities are going to be reduced. There are ongoing models, so I can't give you a definitive answer, but there are ongoing modeling to understand what is the longest duration expected for the mission. I think the nominal mission is about 1 year.
How is it that you will be determining whether or not the core is solid or liquid?
Sorry?
How will you be determining whether or not the core is solid or liquid?
Yeah, yes. So there are two... I can show you something if we have a minute. And if this works. Yes. So you know the experience with the egg. Where you have a raw egg and you have a cooked egg, and they are not going to spin the same way. So it's the same thing for Mars. It doesn't spin the same way if it has a liquid core and if it has versus a solid core. And so there are going to be variation in its axis of rotations that depend on the nature of the core. You have the solid and you have the liquid. Core on the right. So that's going to be the same thing. The other possible source of information is if there are seismic sources that are strong enough to generate waves that go very deep in the interior of Mars and are recorded by the seismometer. But I mean, this is more difficult to predict. Just measuring the precession and nutation of the spin axis of Mars, you know, it's a very powerful way to get information on the core structure.
So there's not presently any seismometers on the surface of Mars. I mean, sensors, seismic sensors. So would you have a sensor?
Yeah, yes. So we don't have seismometers on Mars. It's been, I mean, the idea of sending seismometers to Mars 30 years old, maybe. Yeah, and I think these things have been discussed, like saying if as part of the deployment system there is something to crush that could generate a signal. All this, you have to understand that we are in the early phase of the development of the mission, so I don't want to speak for the project and give you information that may not be accurate. So stay tuned and with the InSight website to see what's going on.
When you answer, please.
Yeah, I'm sorry. French talk very fast. So how directional you mean the seismometer?
Yes.
Yes. I can show you. Sorry. So basically, you have only one seismometer. On Earth, we have hundreds of seismometers. So when there is a seismic event, it's very relatively easy to find the source. I don't know why it's not working. I'm sorry. So basically, when you have, I want to show you. So when you have a seismic event, you are going to have multiple waves generated as part of the event. And if there is structure, if you have discontinuities in the interior because you have chemical gradients, for example, or you have melt, what's going to happen is that there is going to be a reflection of these waves on these interfaces, and these are going to generate new waves. So the seismic record, it's going to be a combination of, a variety of waves, and there is a modeling component involved in understanding, which waves correspond to what. And but each internal structure should have a relatively unique seismic signature. So for that, let's say this is your seismic record on the left. There is some work involved in inferring from the seismic record the velocity of the various waves in the interior and whether or not there are interfaces deep in the interior.
So both where the
Yeah, with the arrival time analysis, you can get some clue about the source. It's not accurate. So if the source is impact, for example, we can rely on images from MRO that will also survey, you know, the evolution of the surface, and that will be relatively easy. If we have fault rupture, it should give a very unique type of seismic fingerprint, if you want. And we can get an idea of how far the event was from the source, but we cannot pinpoint it. We can just have a guess based on our understanding of the geology.